All right, Miss Ni Luputu, yes, the presenter also can join another room and you can also stay in this room. Thank you. Hello everyone, it's nice to see you again. Before we start the last parallel, I would like to ask the presenters, maybe the first presenters, to try the share screen. Miss Agnes Rizka Pravita, are you here?
Yes, okay. I'm going to try to do the screen sharing. Okay, can you see my screen?
Yes, I can see it. Thank you. Okay, do you have any problem to the next slide?
Oh, it's fine. It's fine.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Should I stop it?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. For the second presenter, Miss Margareta Sulistyowardani. Are you here?
Yes, I'm here.
All right, could you please to share your screen?
Oh, actually I have, if I'm not mistaken, I have sent a pre-recorded video because I'm not sure the connection here is good. I have given to the committee. Have you received that?
Wait, I will ask the operator.
Okay.
I'm sorry, you said that you have already sent the recording.
Mm-hmm.
Wait. All right, I have already told the committee as well.
Mm-hmm.
And also I would like to ask you to wait for a minute because our committee will search for it.
Okay.
Do you have the PPT or the recording?
Oh yeah, okay. Here? I will try sharing it here.
Uh-huh.
Hopefully if I have to do it live, there will be no any technical issue. Okay. So this one will be the, okay. Can you see the screen?
Yes, I can see it.
Okay.
Thank you. And later, if my committee already found it, I will share it, the recording as well. But if our committee haven't got it, you can just present your presentation when it is time to your turn. Thank you very much, Ms. Margareta Sulistyowardani. And I would like to ask, the third presenters, Mr. Johan. Are you here? I think he's not ready. I mean, haven't in the room as well. All right. All right. Good afternoon for ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Parallel Session 4 of the 7th International LLTC 2020. It's in the Zoom meeting. My name is Tiara as a moderator, and I'm a fifth semester student of English Language Education Study Program, and I'm glad to see you again in this last Parallel Session. I will be in charge of this Parallel Session. Before we start this Parallel, let me to read the rules. First, each presentation will last for 15 minutes. Second, the three presentations will be delivered in a row. Third, we will have Q&A session after all the presenters have finished. The chat box will be opened from now, so if you have a question, you may directly address it there. Don't forget to put your name, underscore your affiliation as well. All right, let's start the first presentation. There are three presenters in this room. They are first Ms. Agnes Rizka Pravita and Ms. Margareta Sulistyowardani and also Mr. Johan Cahyadi. Let's start the presentation entitled Exploring English as a Lingua Franca Perspective in Conversation Class of Industrial Engineering Program, and it will be delivered by Miss Agnes Rizka Pravita from Sanata Dharma University. To remind you all again that the presentation will take 15 minutes, and if you have already found your question, you can address the question on the chat box Don't forget to put your name underscore of your affiliation. Right. Miss Agnes Rizka Pravita, the time is yours.
Okay, thank you, Miss Chiara. So I would like to share my screen. Okay, can you see my screen, guys? Okay.
Yes, I can
thank
see
you.
It.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. So my name is Agnes. I'm from Sanata Dharma University. I'm now pursuing my master's program in English education. So today I would like to present a research that I have conducted titled as Exploring English as a Lingua Franca Perspective in Conversation Class of Industrial Engineering Program. Okay. In this globalized world, people are demanded to possess several survival skills, and one of them is communication skill, as we know. And in order to be able to communicate with the world citizen, people are demanded to be able to communicate in international language, which is English. And according to the Article 34 of the Charter of the ASEAN, it states that the working language in ASEAN shall be English. Furthermore, it cannot be neglected that nowadays actually English speakers around the world has been dominated with non-native English speakers. As a global means of communication, English has been increasingly used by non-native speakers because of the spread of English non-native speakers, English as a lingua franca has gained a lot of attention over the years in the research field. And due to the use of ELF communication, then it leads as well to a growing interest in what has been known as ELF in ELT or English language teaching. And realizing this, some researchers have stated that we should acknowledge the fact that people who think they are learning English as a foreign language actually end up using English as a lingua franca for communication. And actually, ELT has been focusing on all about grammar, vocabulary, pronunciation, and that it is claimed it is the core of communication. On the other hand, on grammatical accuracy, or accent serves no significant role in dealing with ELF communication, since the functional effectiveness as ELF speakers mainly use is more important than the formal correctness. And it is also explained that ELF communication, in ELF communication, negotiation and adaptation are described as the key features. So therefore, it is then added that the world has started to acknowledge the existence of English as a lingua franca. But unfortunately, in ELT, the teaching practices, assessment, and ELT and the materials still remain focusing on native speaker norms. So some researchers have concluded that there is such an urgency on the needs to improve ELT resources in ways that it suits the evolving needs of ELF learning. And okay. And furthermore, actually in some contexts in German and Japan, some researchers have conducted several research in investigating whether the speakers there, the non-native English speakers there, agree towards the perspective of ELF. But they still state that they acknowledge the existence of ELF, but they still prefer a native English as the norms to be used in ELT. But then in 2009, there is an investigation in Iran, that it is conducted to 120 students in public high school. It revealed that it is found that there was positive attitudes towards ELF. Therefore, in this research, the researcher aimed to investigate whether ELF perspective is implemented in the industrial engineering program, specifically in Conversation Plus. So actually in industrial engineering program, in Conversation Plus, the lecturers have created a textbook to equip students to be able to possess English communication skill. And then the topics and learning activities included was made based on the competence they have formulated, and it is intended for the university students only. Because of that, then this research aimed to investigate whether English Conversation Plus textbook of Industrial Engineering Study Program Semester 2 reflected an English as a lingua franca perspective concerning the content, and how the students' attitudes towards the implementation of ELF perspective in the classwork. Okay, regarding the research background, these are the literature review used in this research. First is English as a lingua franca, English textbook, and students' attitudes. As you can see here, here are several references to be used. And here is the definition. ELF is considered as a vehicle of communication amongst people who do not share a common mother tongue and who use English as communication. Who use English for communication. And actually there are two approaches to language teaching. First, it is called conventional one, in which it focuses on the language element and native speaker element. While another one is another approach, it is called as a lingua franca, English as a lingua franca perspective, in which you would see language teaching as a might wider process involving a whole range of communication skills, knowledge, and attitude, such as communication strategies, pragmatic competence, and language and cultural awareness. And the next one, I'm going to define what does it mean by textbook. It is, textbooks are considered as the main tool for ELT. They provide information and guides about the target language. In this case, as the textbook, which has been created by the English lecturers in the class. The next one, I'm going to use the term attitudes. So here is the definition. So students' attitudes on learning determine their ability on willingness to learn. So in conducting the research, I employed a qualitative study using content analysis, observation, open-ended questionnaire, and then the data analysis was done by conducting selective coding. For the content analysis, I used the content analysis from Tomlinson Masuhara in 2013, Said Holfer in 2011, and Federal Lopriore in 2013. And for the attitude, for the student's attitude, I used Sorak 2015 and Curran and Churn in 2017. After conducting the data collection, then it is the results of the data analysis. So these are the learning objectives and topics used in the textbooks. So there are some colors I have highlighted here. Here are the results of my analysis based on the code that I have selected based on Tomlinson and Masuhara. So there are a red, yellow, and blue. So let's just go further for the first question, for the first research question, then regarding the presence or absence of reference of native speaker norms in and ELF. So based on the previous slides, it was found that there are more than one objectives mentioning about the language elements. It is shown that it actually contradicts to ELF perspective. However, based on the observation, the implementation is not focusing on the norms of the language element itself, but it focuses on how the students use this particular language elements. And then the next one is effective localization. So what does it mean by effective localization? So it is shown in the previous one, in the discussion topics, they are actually close related to their experience and settings. They are asked to communicate their knowledge about the topic closely related to them in English. And in this unit, the students make the use of intercultural communication strategies. So as we can see, it should be the yellow one, then present their heroes. Heroes can be the heroes origin from Indonesia, and then the discuss the possibility of Indonesian animation companies to compete with the Philippines companies. So they can closely relate it to their experience. The next one, language familiarization. And this criterion, the investigation aims to decide whether and how the materials and tasks aimed at establishing a connection with the use of English in actual out-of-school context and circumstances. So it is done in order to familiarize learners with the role of language and the use of ELF in certain things, certain settings. The last one, promotion on communication strategies. So this textbook facilitates students to promote communication strategies, because mostly the activities conducted is speaking activities. And then the next one, for the second research question, based on the observation and interview, it was found that the textbook and the ELF perspective facilitate communication and then motivate participation, and then that it is flexible and encouraging for the students to speak up, to be more active, to be more involved in the classroom activity, and that it is contextual learning, because it is closely related to their experiences and their settings. So based on the research then, I can conclude that the textbook in English conversation, the English conversation class textbook, reflected ELF perspective, and the students showed positive attitudes towards the implementation of ELF perspective in the class. But however, it was found that there were few parts of the textbook showing the reference of native speaker norms in teaching which contradicted to ELF perspective. And due to the limitation of the study, further research is needed to measure the English mastery of the students in the class implementing ELF perspective. So as what have been presented by Dr. Sayer previously, that ELF is one of the ways to bring students to the target language, which is English. But there are so many ways. It depends on the goals of the course itself. While in this course, the goal is to be able to facilitate students to be able to communicate in English language. So I think that's all my presentation. Thank you so much.
Very well. Thank you very much, Ms. Agnes Rizka Pravita. That was an awesome presentation. I would like to give some feedbacks to you. I have heard about the ELF before this conference, I think, maybe yesterday. It's such as new for me because Ms. Agnes just relate it to the industrial engineering, and it's such as I've got the new perspective relatedness to the industrial engineering, and thank you very much for sharing it for us, and that was really engaging presentation. All right,
thank you.
You're welcome. We will move to the second presentation entitled A Critical Evaluation of the Government Mandated High School English Textbook, Whose Culture is Represented from EIL Perspective. My operator will try to share the recording, and if the recording is good enough to you, I will do the recording as well. And if the recording is not really good to be played, and would you mind to share your screen share and then explain it to the forum, ma'am?
Yes.
Okay, let me see the recording and I will ask them the clearness throughout the video. Okay, my operator will share it.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for joining this parallel session. I am Margareta Sulistiowardhani.
Is that clear enough, participants and ma'am?
Yes, I think it's clear for me.
Okay, thank you very much. And my operator will share it. 15 minutes, starting from now.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for joining this parallel session. I am Margareta Sulistiowardhani from English Language Studies Program, Universitas Sanata Dharma. And today I will present you my research. It is a critical evaluation of the government-mandated high school English textbook from EIL perspective, Whose Culture is Represented. English is currently used not only as a means of communication among its native speakers or a way for its non-native speakers to communicate with its native speakers, but also it is used as a means of communication among all people in the world. Realizing and acknowledging this situation, EIL scholars recognize the existence of various varieties of English that are used around the world. Referring to cultural concentric circle, we have American English and British English for the inner, Indian and Singaporean English for the outer circle, and for the expanding circle, well, probably one day there will be Indonesian English varieties. Who knows? Several researchers apparently studied that already. EIL scholars also recognize that what language is used and how it is used is a factor of both the purpose of the communication and the speaker's first language, culture, and level of expertise in English. They argue that the construct of one's English depends on the various factors. However, there is this problem called native speakerism, defined by Holiday as a pervasive ideology within ELT, characterized by the belief that native speaker teachers represent a Western culture from which spring the ideals both of the English language and of English language teaching methodology. In short, there are three native brands promoted here: the who, the native teachers; the what, that is the ideals of English language, and the how to teach or the ideals of ELT methodology. Several scholars in the 1990s are found to contradict the native speakerism. We don't emphasize that the idea of proper is a matter of appropriate, not of being appropriated. So the proper English and English teachings actually depends on the context. Kachru also addressed it by mentioning 6 fallacies of English use and users, to which he said that these fallacies are only partially true and only have less strong empirical evidence. So, the issue has been present for at least 20 years ago. The question is whether it is still relevant today. Apparently, yes, it is still relevant. The debate of nest and non-nest still exists. And it's about the perception or attitudes toward the labels nest and non-nest. It concerns the issue of teachers' identity, and it's also discussed under the theme of the sustainability of linguistics and cultural diversities. And that's still about the who. About the what and the how, there are the pursuance of native speaker competence, emphasis on Western-oriented method, and the manifestation of the two altogether in English textbooks. This brings us to the question, what about English textbooks in Indonesia? Therefore, I conducted this study. The study aims to examine to what extent Indonesian Ministry of Education and Culture endorsed EFL textbook prepared the students to use English in global context. In order to do that, this study has 2 research questions. The first one, does the textbooks adopt native speakerism? And does the textbooks promote English as an international language? And the study employs Hu and McKay's multidimensional analytic scheme, which focuses on pedagogical orientation, portrayal of English use and users, building the sphere of interculturality, language ideology, and critical framing of ELT. And now we will go to findings and discussion. Pedagogical orientation regards whether or not the textbooks adopt the native's pedagogical orientation, characterized by the use of pair or group work, focusing on oracy skills, and the use of opinion or debate. In this dimension, the textbooks does not adopt the 3 as the dominant method. Portrayal of English and English use and users features 4 dimensions. The first one is about the topics. In this case, Indonesian context dominate, followed by other or unspecified context, Anglo-American, and then the last is followed by other Western context. The second dimension of the portrayal regards the people or places or events. Again, in this dimension, Indonesians dominate, followed by the Western people, places, or events. Regarding the pattern of communication, there are not many interactions in the textbook. And among the few, Indonesian communication dominates the textbook. Next, we go to the use of English in local life world. To this, the textbooks insufficiently facilitates the exploration of the use of English in local life worlds. It only explores notable figures and places and focus on structure identification of a text. Now moving to the concept of building the sphere of interculturality, especially regarding the content, the textbooks provide limited opportunities. There are writing an email to foreign pen pals. It's only writing, not sending them. And describing students' ever visited place, writing a local legend, writing and performing a script about local folk tales, and describing learners' favorite songs. And the textbooks does not really promote multiculturality as well, since it stops at presenting the multiculturality, not dig more into it. It is indeed stated in the content mapping of the book, but in reality, it does not go that deep. And regarding the dimension of cross-cultural communication skills or strategies, there is no activity which facilitates students to have those. In chapter one, for example, there are emails from fictional students from other countries, but the contents are merely about names, schools, hobbies, and dreams. The discussion in the textbooks focuses on the structure identification of the emails. Actually, it is a potential activity, but it was not addressed that way. It is not addressed for facilitate students with cross-cultural communication skills or strategies. And about the multilingualism in school and society, it stops in the vocabularies. So there are several patterns here. The first one is the provision of Indonesian equivalents. So it is shown by the vocabulary learning activities. And there is another pattern in which the textbooks use non-English phrases and accompanied by its translation. For example, PMI or PMI, the Indonesia Red Cross. Or there is also this one from the Dutch language, which is translated into the treason of the Ku Umar. There are also several vocabularies which are not translated, such as Ukir Jepara and also Mukim. Ukir Jepara is a specific carving pattern from Jepara, while Mukim is an administrative area smaller than a sub-district in Aceh. And for the language ideology, there will be two points to be addressed here. The first one is the perspective on code switching. I will give you an example here. It is an email from a fictional Malaysian student. So in the opening, there is the word Assalamualaikum. It means that the code switching, which regards religious values, are preserved. It is probably because the curriculum promotes spiritual competence. And next, there is also the sentence, at school, we are supposed to use English at all times. So we have become quite fluent, although sometimes we slip back into Malay, which is our mother tongue. The sentence implies that there is a pride in the use of English for daily communication at school. While there is negative attitude towards the use of code switching, even though in Malaysia, English is actually the second language. The second point regards the modeled English variation. This is the analysis of the international phonetic alphabets in vocabulary learning activities based on American English and British English. As displayed in the screen, there are pronunciation patterns which follow British pronunciation, while there are also ones which follow Americans. So these findings show three probabilities. First, the textbook still adopts natives model, but they are mixed. So it can use both American or also British English or any other native models. Second, the textbooks does not regard as important to follow certain variety. That's the second probability. Or the third probability, this is the pronunciation pattern of Indonesian English, probably. It cannot be confirmed yet. And the last regards the critical framing of ELT. In this study, there is no significant findings. There is only one point in the textbooks which implies the mastery of English as a capital, since it will allow someone to communicate with people from other countries, both Anglophone and no Anglophone countries. For example, the letters from fictional students from Malaysia and the US. So now we arrived at the conclusion. The study examined the extent of the presence of native speakerism and the extent of whether the textbooks promote English as international language. So from the findings, it can be concluded that there is a faint presence of native speakerism. Considering the pedagogical orientation, the textbooks prefers individual work to pair or group work, literacy-based activities to oral activities, and fact-based input or output to debate or opinion. Regarding the context of English use and the English users, the contexts are dominated by Indonesian settings and Indonesian interlocutors of English. In addition, the cultural values being promoted are mostly Indonesians. So it implies that the native speakerism does not dominate these textbooks. However, regarding the promotion of English as international language, it can be said that the book is still lacking. The exploration stops at basic text or image comprehension and linguistics analysis. The portrayal of English use and users are imbalanced because it's being oriented mostly on Indonesian context and not on the exploration of other culture. And last, cross-cultural communication skills or strategies are not promoted in this textbook. Okay, so I think that's all of my presentation. Thank you for your attention.
All right, and thank you very much for the engaging presentation. I think it's such as new because you record the presentation and then you can manage your time as well. And I really appreciate it. You have, if I'm not mistaken, 15 minutes the presentation? Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you very much for managing it to be so the time is really you make the time before 15 minutes. All right, I will move to the third presentation entitled Indonesian Non-Native English Language Teachers, if I'm not mistaken, from Mr. Johan Cahyadi. You here already?
Yes, hello. Can you hear my voice?
Yes, of course. I can hear your voice as well.
Okay.
Okay. Wait, I'll wait for a minute.
Okay.
If I'm not mistaken, your title is Indonesian Non-Native English Language Teachers?
It's about the how does non-native speakerism influence the self-perceived credibility of Indonesian English language teachers. Yeah, around the topic is similar.
Oh, I see. Thank you very much. The third presentation will be delivered by Mr. Johan Cahyadi,
yes.
And the presentation will take 15 minutes. And I remind you all that if you already have the question, you can directly addressing into the chat box as well. Don't forget to put your name, underscore the affiliation, or if you want to ask the presenters directly, in the Q&A session, you can raise your hand by click the icon, the raise hand icon in the Zoom. And 15 minutes from now, Mr. Johan Cahyadi, the time is yours.
Okay. Okay, good afternoon, everyone. I'm happy to be here because there were some technical difficulties that I couldn't join early, and there was some misunderstanding before because I didn't get the emails, so I just log in just now, but it's okay. And yeah, I would like to share. Actually, this was my research around 1 year ago in my sociolinguistic classes. This is about the native speakerism. It's similar to the prior presentation. So this is the topic. It's actually the problem that I want to tackle is how do non-native speakers in Indonesia can compete actually with the native speakers teaching English. So why do we need to tackle this problem? Because from what I experience, native speakerism is still going strong in Indonesia in some area. But now I hope that it will not be like that anymore, because non-native English speakers can also compete with the native speakers with the correct credibility. That's what my topic is all about. So it's non-native speakers encouraged to apply. Okay, this is the problem, my background of study. So what I found that in job poster or advertisement, there are a lot like native English teacher recruitment, and you have to be US, UK, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, or South Africa nationality. And instead of background, nationality background, why must we have that background? Why not credibility? Okay, so let's go to the my research question. How about Indonesia? In Indonesia context, from my experience, many English classes depend on speaking natural ELT. So they often depend on native English speakers to be the role model. Naturally, of course, English native speakers is preferred as holiday in 2018 rather than non-native English speakers. So my research question was, how about non-native English speakers who teach English in Indonesia? Do their credibilities will suffer if they are just being a non-native English speakers? Okay, this research aims at uncovering how Indonesian NSC teachers perceive their credibility compared to the NEST counterparts, and how do native speakerism play a part in this debacle? Okay, then, this is the ideology versus the native English teacher and the non-native English teacher. Okay, then, my method of study, I use case study approach using Yin and narrative inquiry, Connolly and Clendenin in 1990, and this method presents in-depth investigation. So I made a lot of interviews, several interviews, and then also I use questionnaires to dig deeper into their narratives, and then how do they describe themselves to the students. Okay, then, the study employed semi-structured interviews, questionnaires, and post-interviews to obtain meaningful data from them. And then I had three non-native English speaking teachers selected for their various educational background and subject. All participants are Indonesian origins. Okay, this is the first participant profile. It's Mr. Ray. He was graduated from Master of Business Administration. It's very interesting because he teaches English, but his background is MBA, and then Master of Management from a local university. And even his bachelor degree was a Bachelor of Science. So he was not an English graduate or English literature or linguistic study. So he has 8 years of experience, and then also certified TEFL and TKT, certified professional. Mr. Ray teaches Indonesian language to Korean as well as English, and he manages the operation of the language institution. Okay, that's the first. And then the second participant was Mr. Andre. He finished undergraduate and graduate program in English literature, and then he has around 6 years of experience teaching English, specializing in business English and TOEFL preparation course. And then the third participant was Miss Clarissa. She had around 11 years of experience, and she also graduated from English literature, but she graduated from Eversus graduate program in UK, while Mr. Andre fully graduated from local university. Okay, this is my findings. First finding is from Ray's narrative. belajar bahasa Inggris modal utamanya adalah percaya diri and how English can be applied in the daily life. So, our question as an English teacher, how do we have the self-confidence? And then, as he started learning English in junior school, he found an ideal or model English teacher who is non-native English speaker. So in this way, I found that not only native English teacher can become a model, but also a non-native English speaker teacher. And how the teachers connect to the students and engagement is very important. Okay, and Ray also stated, mengajar itu seperti menyanyi. It's like singing. Nggak mungkin kan, kan nadanya hanya do saja. Pasti kita perlu kombinasi. So we need combination. And bagaimana membuat sebuah lagu enak didengar. And how do we make that song is easy to listen and also the teacher who motivate us, motivate me. And jadi bukan hanya teorinya. So it's not only theory. And however, Ray also emphasized that native foreign source is more credible source of English, while the non-native local source is for passing the national exam at school. This phenomenon is also good as a new research. And I found that this might have some implication in our pedagogy in schools. And then next is the teaching performance of the teachers. Ray emphasized that teaching performance is the most important in the self-perceived credibility and how the framework of thinking when teaching is very important in the teaching performance, such as flowing framework of thinking and then flowing speaking. And also he also noted that similar qualification and educational background are important to teacher's credibility. So qualification and then teaching performance and then a native foreign source and also how the teachers engage with the students are very important. And then he didn't care whether the teacher graduated from inner circle country or only had a local qualification. So he didn't care about the whether it is UK or US qualification or a nationality. Okay, and then this is the other things. In conclusion, what makes an English teacher credible is not related to the native or non-nativeness, according to Ray. Instead, it is more to the method and the way the teacher or lecturer teach are much more important. That's what Ray's emphasis. Okay. Next finding. My next finding is Andre's narrative. The interview lasted for around 15 minutes. Actually, it's more than 15 minutes, but what I obtained, the meaningful data is only for around 15 minutes. He started learning English from English songs and MTV, if you know MTV, that is often played in the TV in 1990s. And he also greatly learned English from computer games and other game consoles and learning formally at school. So I hope that engages it related to our experience. And his experience learning English at school was inflexible because the teacher always taught the grammar and vocabulary. But he also emphasized that a teacher that comes from non-English major that taught him English, the result was disaster. So his experience was non-English background was disaster as a teacher. That's debatable though. And then his first ideal teacher was in elementary school where he was taught to learn English through songs, pictures, again, songs, pictures, fairy tales, and folk tales. He still remembers that teacher. Okay, next. And then he often pointed that engagement and clear explanation are very important as the, and also attitude. Teacher who does not force his or students to perform make the material interesting so that students can enjoy the learning process. I think, yeah, it resonates with us when we learn English in with a fun teacher. And for teaching, he also revealed that a teacher needs a standard for performance. It does not relate to being a native or non-native that will reflect the credibility. Lastly, okay, Andre didn't mention any idealized image of English teacher. And then he also stated, kalau kita mau meniru seseorang, the ideal teacher, which is the his or her specialty, we will not be able to, because including native speakers. Contohnya, in his experience, he experienced a teacher who has the jago main sulap, is a sleight of hand, and then muridnya sangat senang diajar oleh dia, and his students love being taught by him. And then he also noted that teachers who do not have similar qualification to the discipline is not that credible. So it's similar to the Ray narrative. The perceived credibility of the teacher in relation to the where teacher graduates did not really matter. So he also disagreed with the native speakerism. And then, however, when asked whether a native or non-native teacher could help more in teaching English, he agreed that native English speaking teacher can help him more compared to a non-native English speaker, because it helps fostering the confidence in speaking English using British or American accent. This is interesting when it is about speaking. Usually, Indonesian prefers the native English speaker. So, but in other things like grammar and vocabulary, it might be not. Non-native English speaking teacher is okay. Okay, and then the third participant is Clarissa. Clarissa reiterated this twice. Regardless apakah seorang penutur asli or not, bahkan seorang guru bukan, yang penting dia bisa mengajar English. So she emphasized the performance or the competence of the teacher, whether he or she is a native speaker or not. And then Clarissa also compared experience learning and teaching English in the inner circle country in the UK. She stated me that in the UK, she got three professors teaching in one class, and she was confused which one should she follow. That's interesting, because I thought that in inner circle country, the standard performance of teaching English should be better than in Indonesia compared to Indonesia. But in there, she experienced that in her master's degree was not always a better experience. She strongly agreed that English teacher must have the same qualification as the major deities. Actually, it's the similar with my two participants before. So to some extent, to build more credibility or trustworthiness. Okay. And then next, she noticed also that being a native speaker advantages as being perceived as more credible, at least initially, when we enter into a classroom for the first time, usually people will she told me that as a native English speaker, we have that initial advantage. But in the long run, both should have the same chance or opportunity. And then another Clarissa reiteration was the perceived credibility of a teacher does not have any relation whatsoever with the teacher's nationality origin. Also, gender and race must not have place in judging the credibility of teacher. This is very important point that she raised. We should have the same opportunity for both non-native English speaking teacher and also native English speaking teacher. And then a credible teacher must be able to teach being a native or non-native teacher. Okay, discussion. From the result, two of the three perceived credibility, which is trustworthiness and effective factor, mostly are not related to the non-native speakers. So I use Finn in 2009, Finn and her friends, so her colleagues, they research about the credibility and trustworthiness, what factors affect the trustworthiness, affection, and then also the competence factor. There are three factors in the credibility: the trustworthiness, the affection or caring factor, and the competence factor. Ray prioritized trustworthiness, and then Andre the affection, and then Clarissa emphasized the competence factor. All of them agreed that competence is one of the most important required perceived credibility factor, although the priority is different. Okay. This competence factor is important, as in the previous study with Cook, a neutral term in linguistics for native speakers, knowledge of language. So native speakers have the advantage of having the inherent linguistics capability. But even though all three, from my study, from all the three participants, they agreed that non-native speakerism does not influence the perceived credibility of the teacher. It's more to the performance and then to the trustworthiness and then the affection instead of the non-native speakerism ideology. As what Mosu in 2018 said, positive characteristics, we actually can learn from this that first they set a good learner model to their students as the race said, and then they can instruct language learning strategies more effectively. Why? Because they also learners. They need to devise various language learning strategies and then give more information to the language because they learn deeper, even deeper than the native speakers usually. And then they understand the intricate difficulties and the needs of their students because they are students. We are students ourselves as a non-native English speakers. And then they can anticipate and predict language difficulties and then use the student's native language to their advantage. I think from Mosu, we can conclude that as a non-native English teacher, we do not need to feel inferior or something like that, but we need to be confident. And as long as we have the competence, I think we can compete with the native English speaking teachers. This is several factors need to be addressed in this entrance ideology that native speaker is more credible than non-native speakers. That is by judging and assessing the credibility from qualifications, experience, and three models of credibility instead of the categorization of native and non-native. I think that's all. This is my questionnaires. And then, yeah, this is the reference. I think, yeah, it's finished. Any questions for the session?
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Johan, for the awesome presentation. I would like to give some maybe feedback or comments to your presentation. I think I agree with you that it is still debatable between the native speakers and also non-native speakers. But I think as long that it's still in English regulation, it's okay, isn't it? But I also ever heard about the statement from the people that said the native speakers is better because they have the mother tongue, so they know well about their language, I think. But it also many people around the world are more good than the native speaker itself. It depends on who the people are, I think. Thank you very much for the awesome presentation. I would like to move to the Q&A session. For the first round, I will invite three questions. Please click on the right hand icon on your Zoom if you want to directly ask the presenters and give your name, also affiliation, before ask the question. Or you can addressing your question on the chat box and fill it with your name underscore affiliation, then write your question. And don't forget to refer to whom you would like to ask. Okay, you can, maybe you would like to raise your hand if you want to ask something to the presenters. Maybe from the chat box. Maybe here we have some students from university or maybe in the seventh semester. You can directly ask them if you want to start your thesis, maybe. Or you would like to ask the recommendation of your title. I can see also here. Oh, the speakers from another conference also included in this Zoom. Maybe you want to ask something to the presenters. If they're not, may I ask the presenters? All right. While waiting the questions from the participants, I would like to ask the three presenters today, what makes you all interested in picking your title in this abstract? And what makes you motivate to talk about it? Maybe the third person, the three presenters can directly answer my question. Who would like to be the first one? Maybe Miss Agnes, would you mind?
Okay, thank you, Miss Chiara, for the question. So, what made me interested in this topic is because ELF perspective, as I what I have mentioned before, English language perspective, it is actually has been widely acknowledged as the perspective which is able to facilitate the non-native English speakers to master English in order to facilitate them to be able to communicate with the world citizen. So in communicating in English, the focus is not only on the language element, but the focus is on how we negotiate meaning. Therefore, unfortunately, the textbook or the teaching practices approaches materials, specifically in Indonesia, it is not that much. So, and fortunately, I was involved in the course to teach industrial engineering program in which we created the textbook. So I was interested to analyze whether the textbook facilitated the students to be able to communicate in English with the ELF perspective. And I wanted to see the students' attitudes and motivation in the classroom. Were they motivated to speak up? Were they willing to be actively involved in the class by having the perspective of ELF in the class and not focusing on the language element? So that's it, I think. Thank you.
All right, thank you very much for the first our first presenter. Is it okay to me to take the question from chat box first before the two presenters ask my question before?
Hello.
Sure, please.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, we have the question from Miss Anastasia Camelia. For the last speakers, if I'm not mistaken, Mr. Johan, do you think the non-native struggle is in learning English can also influence the ability of non-native speaker to teach English better than native? Thank you. The time is yours, Mr. Johan, to ask the question. To answer the question.
Okay, thank you for the questions, Ms. Anastasia. Yes, of course, the non-native struggle in learning English is real and can also influence the ability of non-native speaker to teach English better than native. The reason is, from my study, from the experience of three non-native English speaking teachers, they have the ability and also the experience in teaching even the non-native English speaking students. So from my example, the teacher taught the Korean students. So they learn Bahasa Indonesia or Indonesian and English. How do they fare or teach English better? Because we can give example as what I shared in the presentation here. Wait a minute. Let me share a little bit the one. Okay. Wait a minute. Yeah. This the result that. Okay. Can you see the share the screen?
I think no? It's still loading.
Loading. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay then. I think it's screen sharing is I think not I cannot share my screen, so I just talk it out. How do we fare better than the native English speaking teacher is from the MOSU study in 2018 about native and non-native English teachers. The first is we can set a good learner model as we are the non-native English speaking student. We struggle in learning English. I remember from my experience, I was not the best. I was even the worst in English class in my junior high school. I got bad in the learning, and then I struggled to learn English. But a teacher, a non-native English teacher, I remember her name is Miss Ita. So she taught me grammar, and then she taught me vocabulary, and also speaking is very important, and in listening. I still remember that she set the example as the English speaking teacher. So it's even better than native, because another example is from my colleagues. She teaches English, and she learned English from like in a course by native speaker, if I'm not mistaken, Wall Street Journal. Sorry if I use or some kind of EF, or they have featured native English teacher. But my colleagues have difficulties in understanding the material, because the native English speaking teacher speaks very fast. So I think as a non-native English speaking teacher, we have the advantage of understanding the students better. Yeah, I think that's it. Yeah, thank you.
All right, thank you very much for our third presenters. But we still have 3 minutes here. I would take from Clara, Miss Clara, for a third speaker again. How did you validate your study? Okay, you want to ask answer it directly, Mister?
Okay. Yes, I validated my study using post interviews. So I use 3 phases of methodology. The first is initial interview. I ask the participants to read the interview question, and then I recorded it. And then after that, I use questionnaires to find whether the questionnaire is similar in answer with the interview. And then the last one is the post interviews. I use the post interviews to triangulate the first initial interview, and then the questionnaire, and then last. Yeah, I think that's it. Validate my study.
All right, thank you very much for answering that. I would like to ask Miss Clara, is that clear enough for you? Or all right. Okay, thank you very much for asking for our third presenter. Unfortunately, that's the end of our panel session. Thank you for joining. I really appreciate your participation in this room. But before we end the session, I would like to ask all the participants to open the camera, because we will have the photo session. Okay, it's really happy to take the photo session, I think. You can open your camera as well, it's okay. All right. For those who haven't opened the camera, you can start to open your camera now. All right, so I can see your beautiful faces and handsome faces here. All right, thank you very much for opening, I mean. Maybe for Miss Demisari, Miss Regina, Miss Faiza, Simron, I mean Mr. Simron, and Miss Ni Liputu, you haven't opened your camera well. All right, I will take the screenshot session. Don't forget to keep smiling, guys, because it is our last day. Okay, Devrata, are you ready? All right. 1, 2, 3, smile. 1, 2, 3, smile. Okay, you can use your freestyle. Up to you. The new era of freestyle is sarangi, okay, right? 1, 2, 3, kiss. All right, thank you. Is that enough for the photo session? Or you want more? Okay, dear participants, thank you very much for joining us. And after this, you can have your lunch break as well. And thank you for the presenters, for the participants who were asking the questions. And I want to appreciate for all the participants here that have joined our session, and hope this session will take you for the further, maybe the second semester can guide in the abstract later. Thank you very much. You can have leave the Zoom now and take your lunch. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Have a nice day. Don't forget to back to the main room. If what time? Oh, in 1:30, if I'm not mistaken. Thank you, everyone.
I'm going under, and this time I feel there's no one.